keynote speaker is Dr. Wallace Ford. He is Associate Professor and Chair of Public Administration Department at Medgar Evers College, New York, USA. He has extensive experience in both public and private sector. May I request him to please come and deliver his keynote speech?
I do. I've had the opportunity to be involved in many conferences and many organized events like this over the years, and I have some idea of how much work and how much effort and how many obstacles are involved in coming up with a successful event like the one we're participating in today. So I wanted to take a point of personal privilege as your keynote speaker this morning to thank, I want to thank Dr. Shinar and all of his colleagues with the university, but I want to thank the staff that was responsible for all of this organizing, all the things that we don't see getting done during the course of the day and the night and in the early in the morning. And so I want to start by thanking each and every one of you for the really good and hard work that you've done in making this possible. And you can clap for that. Now, it is a pleasure and an honor to represent Medgar Evers College, the City University of New York, at this, the first international conference on management, business, and leadership, organized by the historic Sindh Madressatul Islam University in Karachi. It is a wonder of this world that we share, as it is a wonder of the lives that we live, that no matter how much we plan and visualize, there is no way that we can predict all the things that will happen in this world and in our lives. Now, I personally have been blessed to have visited many places on this planet. I was born in Harlem, in New York City, in the United States. I was educated in Japan. I have worked extensively in Europe, Africa, throughout South America and the Caribbean. Yet on January 1st of this year, ladies and gentlemen, I did not know and I could not have predicted that I'd be sharing the experience of this wonderful conference with the honored guests and hosts in attendance here in my very first visit to Pakistan. And for that, I'm thankful and most appreciative. And I am assured, at least in my expectations, that this will be one of a number of visits back to Pakistan in the future. The topic of my presentation, International Economic Development in the Modern Era, from Conquest and Colonialism to Empowerment and Inclusion, is based upon my appreciation of history and from my professional experience with the many contours and concepts of what is termed international business development. And with your permission, I would like to begin with the historical aspects of this presentation, because it can be safely argued that until the second half of the 20th century, with but a very few exceptions, that will be noted shortly, international economic development was manifested in strategies that began with conquest and then evolved into colonialism. Whether we're talking about Alexander the Great to Genghis Khan, from Napoleon to Hitler, from the Mughal Emperor Akbar to Queen Elizabeth, from Shaka Zulu in Africa to Hannibal in Africa to Julius Caesar, international economic development was effected through conquest. That all great empires, ancient and not so ancient, have been based upon conquest simply cannot be argued. I submit that viewing conquest and its descendant colonialism have been the norm for international economic development until the beginning of the modern era in which we now live. I'm designating the years beginning in the second half of the 20th century until the present for this modern era. For while there are numerous historical accounts of trading alliances between countries, all too often those alliances degenerated into wars, and or the alliances were themselves the result of prior wars and attempted conquests. Now, there can be little argument that the ancient model of international economic development based upon conquest was a result of two things: to expand markets and to acquire resources to enhance the economy and national wealth of the nation that initiated the wars and the consequent conquests. The destruction of the target nation, the decimation and enslavement of its people, and the ancillary effect of eliminating the culture of that target nation were typically seen as simply the cost of doing business by the conquering nation. This model was the norm for much of recorded history, from Babylon to Assyria, from the Aztecs in what we now know as Mexico, to the Greeks. And then in the second half of the 16th century, something very remarkable happened. The ascendancy of European civilizations was coincident with the development of superior technology that was remarkably well suited for the conquest, combined with the unprecedented development of travel-related technology. Now, what am I talking about here? Particularly map making, developing maps, and shipbuilding. As Dr. Jared Diamond points out in his groundbreaking book, Guns, Germs, and Steel, his epic account of this planet-changing colonial explosion in world history the European and later the European-American conquest of much of the planet was never due to any kind of mythic racial superiority. Diamond points us out that instead of this obviously rebuttable analysis, it was due to the concentration of certain already mentioned technological developments in Europe, with the unforeseen consequence of the enhanced immune systems inherited from survivors of the Great Plague in Europe. I don't want to get too deep into the science on this, but it's really important because of this immune system development, Europeans in many instances were able to conquer without ever firing a shot. The result was a perfect storm which elevated conquest to a global scale. In a period of less than 400 years, European Americans conquered all of North America, all of South America, much of Asia, and all of Africa, and European Americans prospered in that conquest as no people had in the history of the planet Earth. Now, this unprecedented global conquest was accompanied by additional technological and scientific advances in the so-called Industrial Revolution. And what we now know is that European-American conquest was a war waged upon all the non-European people of the world, which enriched conquerors beyond their wildest dreams, even of their most ambitious ancestors. Okay, so what we now know, of course, is that the great wealth of the British Empire was firmly rooted in the Raj. In other words, rooted in the soil on which we now stand. What we now know is that there is no such entity called the United States of America and its great wealth without genocide committed on the indigenous people of North American continent, killing millions of the original residents of what is now New York to what is now California, while enslaving millions of Africans and decimating the African continent in the bargain. Now, what I'd like to do in the time that I have left is to speak about, and I've spoken about yesterday, about today and tomorrow. Because what we know is that the whole concept of international business development has changed. We now see that the unification and the collaboration and cooperation between countries is what's most important for economic development. There are 300 million people in the United States. There's 500 million people in the European Union. Those combined resources have served, because of collaboration, have served the countries that are involved there quite well in terms of economic development and economic superiority in a number of instances. What we have to understand, though, is that as we look at going forward, the non-European American countries, okay, have to look at a different way of going forward. What am I speaking about? I'm speaking about collaboration and cooperation, which goes past concepts of sovereignty, because sovereignty is no longer of individual nations is no longer the issue. We now are looking at situations where countries have to collaborate and have to cooperate regardless of history. What we know is that certainly, and I'll speak of the experience in Africa, the country lines that are establishing the borders of countries were established in Germany in 1884. Solely by Europeans. The countries, those borders, don't reflect the history, don't reflect the culture. And when we go around the world and other places, we see that those boundary lines are not the defining point of how people can collaborate. What we know is that those boundary lines have to be overcome if indeed we're going to see people that are not European, that are not American, also participate and get involved and get engaged in terms of economic development in the 21st century and beyond. And while these differences are important from a cultural standpoint, from a historical standpoint, I would submit to you that the idea and the need for development, sustainable development, which we talked about yesterday, is going to require a new kind of cooperation and a new kind of recognition in terms of how people go forward, how countries go forward, and so that they too will be a part not only of the present but of the future. So, in closing, one of the things I want to mention, of course, is without the achievement of critical mass in terms of capital, market share, and capital capacity through collaboration and cooperation, it will be very difficult for the former colonies that are now in neo-colonial status to be able to demand and command inclusion in the global economic marketplace. When I speak in terms of empowerment within this presentation of a proposal for change, I am referring to internal and indigenous economic development. I live in a country which is billed as the wealthiest country in the history of the planet Earth. It is true that the United States has the most millionaires, more than any other country. However, income disparities, the actual wealth disparities, are not necessarily seen by the rest of the world, but I assure you that they are there. A country with income and wealth disparities can never be a just country. A country with income and wealth disparities can be the source for political and social unrest that can produce more inequality and more injustice. And I present the United States of America in 2018 in the era of Trump as Exhibit A. So there is nothing permanent about human affairs on this planet. The greatest civilizations in history are now dusty memories in unread books and unvisited libraries. The European hegemony in the European-American hegemony in the marketplace of the world was not inevitable, ladies and gentlemen. And it is certainly not eternal. It will be up to the sons and daughters of the enslaved, the colonized, and the neo-colonized to decide our destiny. It will be up to each of us, my brothers and sisters, to determine what tomorrow will look like, which can only occur if we remember yesterday and understand today. Finally, and truly in closing, for those who might think or suggest that what I propose is impossible, or at the very least improbable, I ask you to look what's in your own hand. You have vision. You have education, and we all live in a world where no one needs to be a stranger and where we can share in dreams and make them all come true. Tomorrow truly belongs to each and every one of us. We need only to seize the time. Stay strong, be great, and embrace the greatness that is already ours. Thank you so very much.